always-on feature in SQL Server 2012 was a key decider for us.
We used automated load generation to ramp up to 100 times what our current production load is. We can drive it at 1,500 game rounds per second, and we know that it gives us a highly available solution as well.
We're reducing the time of our analysis from weeks and months to now it's only days, empowering users to actually do analysis that they wouldn't have been able to do before.
On the Microsoft side, when it comes to business intelligence and databases, have continued to advance and keep up with the innovations that are happening in big data.
In situations where we require the ability to very rapidly scale up and scale down, the Windows Azure platform is actually particularly good.
The benefits for Microsoft SQL Server 2012 are you can deliver more for less cost. It's a win-win situation.
We know that we are protected for the future using it.
Good morning. So welcome to this session. My name is Kurt Drapers. I'm a group program manager in the SQL Server team. And today we're going to talk about SQL Server 2012. Actually, this year is the first time that we're talking about SQL Server 2012 after we have shipped 3 months ago. And so what I want to do is actually take you through the values that customers are seeing today based on customer evidence and talk you through the key pieces of the SQL Server 2012 release. So far, it's like, so we're 3 months into the release, and 600,000 releases or downloads later, we see a tremendous take-up, actually, in this product. As you know, it's like, if you've been with SQL Server a little bit longer than one release, we take our release process very seriously. We work with TAP customers during the development of new products, and we use the input of those customers to get us focused on delivering those aspects that we really need to actually deliver value to your business. What you see on this slide is actually a small collection of the people that helped us shape the SQL Server 2012 release as such. Analysts have been doing their briefings already with regards to return on investments, and only based on upgrading, they actually expect to have almost 190% payback time on moving to SQL Server 2012. But what's more important, actually, is that people like you, developers, DBAs, IT professionals, are talking about SQL Server 2012 in a very positive way, as you can see here by Andy Leonard, who is one of the people that runs SQL Block, which we actually know each other. So SQL Server 2012 is a huge release. As you see here, you probably have to squint through to see everything. It's like, and not even everything fits on this slide. There are literally hundreds of features that we have. Some really landmark features that we always talk about in keynotes, like Power View, you've seen that today. It's like always on. But there are other very modest features that actually add tremendous amount of value. All right. For me, the one that stands out is like it's one of the smaller nuggets, but it's really important. For example, all the T-SQL enhancements that we made, all the windowing functions that we added to actually help developers build better applications and express the logics that they need and had to work around in the past. So as you see, it's like this is a humongous list. So we'll have to zoom in and focus ourselves on a smaller number. So what we're going to do in the next hour, or the 55 minutes that are left of that, is like we're going to talk about these 12 buckets. These 12 areas to talk about what kind of values they add and how they can actually help you build better solutions for your business. So let's first talk about performance. Behind every IT solution is probably a business problem that we're trying to solve. And those business problems have a certain cadence. There are certain requirements. If you have a need, for example, to be able to refresh your reportings or your reports every 24 hours from your business point of view, but it literally takes you a month to actually do this, that wouldn't work for you. That wouldn't solve your business requirements, and at the end of the day, it's like we wouldn't be able to add value. So what we've done, and this is what we do through TAP programs and talking to customers like you, is get to the core of the problems that you're trying to resolve. What are the real problems you're facing? So many improvements were made in SQL Server 2012. For example, SSIS, we spend a lot of time actually improving the ETL pipeline and making sure you can load your data faster. In the SSAS, so the analysis service world and the relational world, we actually made some key investments based on the X-Velocity technology that we introduced under Power Pivot in the SQL Server 2008 release together with Office 10. All right, this allows us to actually take a new approach to navigating over your data sets in a columnar fashion by leveraging the compression techniques that were introduced there. Now, what's even more telling is, like, if you look at a customer like Trend Micro. Trend Micro is a security company in Japan, as you might know. And they have a whole group of research and developer people, 500 roughly, that do analysis. And they do analysis by mining over huge data sets. They do this to identify threats. And so you can see that the timeliness of data is very important. The faster you identify a threat, the faster they can respond. Right now, it took them days to actually gather through and go through the queries to figure out what their results were. So they were an early adopter of the SQL Server 2012 column store functionality, which helped them actually cut down their query times significantly enough that they can now process threats in hours instead of actually days. Was it acceptable response time? But the most important part is actually not that it was that much faster. It gave them an agility to differentiate themselves from their competitors. They could now ask questions which they never could ask before. And therefore, they actually went down and it's like adopted SQL Server 2012. Now, in order to actually show you what's behind this, I want to invite Michael Rees on stage. And Michael is going to talk about how he's actually going to help us build your tree, right? I'm sorry.
Expert. Can you all hear me? Good. So my pleasure here is to show you how we can actually make use of X-Velocity as a technology to make your queries run faster. So this is an example report of some data I have inside my database that shows me retail sales data from the year 2009. So I can drill in here, for example, into what did I sell around customers and cell phones. Now, often when you create such reports, you're creating a semantic model, you're using an OLAP suite or some reporting tool to build your reports ahead of time, and then you basically save them. But often, as Kurt mentioned, in the case of agile investigation of your data, you might not have the time or you might not have the budget to build these models and other reports ahead of time. So you want to do it more agile and more quickly. And so that's why we normally give you support by running your queries, of course, against the database and build simple reports on top of it. So this is the query that is underlying the report that you just saw earlier. So this is a typical warehousing query, star joins. Basically, you have dimensions and facts that you are combining with each other. So let's just show you how big the fact table is. So I go over here and zoom into the fact table here to see how big it is. So let me go down here. Look at the properties and the storage here. And so if you look at the data, you will notice that we have 27 million rows in this database, in this table. Now let's go back and actually run the query. Now this is a query that has no index on it, except for a primary clustered key. So it will be taking a while. Actually, on this rather old laptop, it's going to take about 40 seconds. So while we are doing those 40 seconds, let me kind of talk to you already a little bit about how we're actually going to make this query faster.
Because I hope you have a solution for this, right? Because
yes, we're not sure. Wait. Yeah, of course. Okay. Well, he's very impatient today. So what we can do is we are going to create a new type of index, which is called a column store index, which is basically the packaging of the X-Velocity technology that we already shipped in SQL Server 2008 R2 with PowerView. And we are going to now have this available inside the database. So as you have seen, the query took 38 seconds to execute. Now I can go and simply create this index. So I'm a T-SQL guy, so you see me actually use the T-SQL statement here instead of the wizard. And it's basically a column store index. What this does now is, when I execute it, is that instead of taking the data row by row and putting it into the index, what it's actually doing is it will take the data on a row-by-row basis and compress it across all rows. And therefore, it gives us a much better compression ratio, and we will use much less space in the database to store the index, and therefore we'll get much better query performance as well. And the reason why that works is because the data within a column is normally much more homogeneous and more leads itself more to compression than if you're looking at all the row data at one time.
So we're eliminating repetition.
Exactly. Okay. So now this query is creating an index, of course, takes a long time, over 20 million rows, and I know how impatient Gert is here, so I prepared an additional database where the index already has been created. And now let's just run the same query that we had before again and see what happens. And as you can see, the index query has already been completed. So it takes about 10 times as fast as without the index. And if I would have a much faster laptop here, it would actually just have seen no time at all. So I think that shows you how the new X-Velocity column store technology is actually making your queries go much faster in the data warehousing experience.
All right. Thanks. Thanks, Michael. All right, so that actually shows us how we can leverage your existing data, and just by accessing it smarter through a column compressed in technology, help you with those data warehousing queries over a dimension and fact tables. Now, after performance, of course, is like there are lots of regulations and rules we these days have to comply with. So we did a lot of work to actually make it much easier to manage compliance and security within SQL Server 2012. So we added the notion of user-defined roles at the server level, which allows you to much better manage separation of concern that you might have inside your engine, right? To put people in those roles that you actually need. We reworked the auditing capability that we added in the previous release and made it available in all editions now. So now it's available for you in all editions. And we added capabilities with regards to the notion that you can actually look through your audit logs, for example, for unwanted events in a much more efficient way. So this way is like you can use it to actually help you enforce the compliance and security that you need for your business through a standard product. So the next step, of course, after performance and security, is make sure that we need to have reliability. If you're betting your business on this, and where data is key, it's like you have a requirement with regards to availability. You need the data to be there. You want to be available. You want to limit the downtime that you have inside your server. So across the product, we've made a number of investments to actually improve availability or add availability. For example, integration server. Integration services always used to be this desktop application running from Visual Studio. It was more a developer tool than anything else. Now, a very powerful one. But when it came to business continuity, the ability to run it in a managed way and make sure it's like the ETL load fails over, it wasn't there. So what we did is we made it a service. And we added the capability to actually take your ETL workload and fail it over. We added Stream Insight in the previous release, as you might remember. Stream Insight is a complex event processing engine that allows us to process queries over streams of information that flow through the engine. Now, it's like we have businesses like Formula One, but also high-end financials betting on this technology to actually gain insight in the data that moves through those streams. If you're at the heart of a business process, that service needs to be available. But last but not least, we actually reimagined how we actually do availability in SQL Server through the always-on technology. Before this, we had database mirroring. But we heard from all of you that you want to have choice with regards to, is like you want read-only secondaries. You want to have a choice between asynchronous and synchronous replication between the nodes. And you want to be able to do this in a flexible way, how people or how things can fail over. So one of our TAP customers, actually the city of Virginia Beach, and this is a local government in the U.S. that is actually acclaimed for being one of the most efficiently run IT shops at the local government level. And what the problem they had is like they weren't able to manage their maintenance windows. They couldn't deploy their changes fast enough because of the downtime that they had to take. They had to support 500 servers. And this actually, they had a solution from one of our competitors, but they simply couldn't get through their business needs and drive their requirements. So they moved over to SQL Server 2012, always on. They were actually able to eliminate all their planned downtime as a result of that and save some money at the end. Now, to demonstrate to you how we can actually do that, it's like I'm going to invite Tobias up and have us show us like how we can do this ourselves. You're two, right? Here you go.
Thank you, Gert. So what I have up here is the failover cluster manager. And this is one of the first things to notice is that database mirroring was totally built on top of SQL Server technologies. In SQL Server 2012, we're having a marriage between the failover clustering work that's going on in Windows Server and the SQL Server product. And this helps us improve lots of things, especially the experience that you guys have managing this. So just to show you, I already have these three nodes added to my cluster. Now, the only thing you need to do to use this is you need to install the failover clustering role on your Windows Server machine, and you need to install a normal copy of SQL Server. So a very nice thing now, if I want to go ahead and add more nodes, and I'm, for example, using Hyper-V and having my SQL Server running a VM, I can just add another VM, hit Add Node, and I have that one added. We can just see here, I right-click, Add Node, and this is where I would just enter the server name. So since I already have these guys added, I'll move over to Management Studio. As you can see here, I have connected to all of these machines, SQL 3, 4, and 5. And we have this new always-on folder under the in Object Explorer. So go ahead here and choose New Availability Group, and I'll give my availability group a name. Now, the interesting thing with availability groups is we think about your app rather than databases. So we know that an app many times uses one database and many times uses more than one database. Maybe the app needs five databases. So you guys want to think about those as a unit, as your app. And you obviously want those to fail over together. So I'll call this Contoso AG. That's just the name of my availability group. Then it asks me which databases should be part of the group. Now, the two Fabricam ones here, I can't choose because they're already part of another one. So this means I can create multiple availability groups on various sets of servers. You don't have to have just one per server. So it's aligned again to your app rather than to databases. Now, the last thing I need to do here is add which machines should be part of this. So I'll go ahead and say add replica SQL 3 and SQL 5. And you can notice I have a few settings here. I can say whether or not I want to do automatic failover, so I can do HA, right? Synchronous commit, meaning I will lose no data if in case of a disaster. And I can do asynchronous commit, which is for disaster recovery sites. So you may have your HA solution locally and another machine in some other data center. So I'll go ahead and say that I would like SQL 4 and SQL 3 to be my HA solution, and SQL 5 is my DR solution in another data center. The other thing Gert touched on is readable secondaries, meaning that I can actually use the machines that are not designated as the primary owner of the group for querying, for backups, for things like CheckDB, anything that's a read-only workload. So I can go ahead and just say that I allow this for all of these. Now, the last thing I want to do here is add an endpoint or a listener. So this is, again, giving your app itself a DNS name and an IP address that you can connect to. So you don't have to think about which server you're actually connecting to. This is one of the really big enhancements that we did in SQL Server 2012.
So we're taking care of provisioning this for you, right?
Yes, exactly. So I'll go ahead and call this Contoso 1. I want to use port 1433 and DHCP. So I have a DNS server set up as well, and we automatically go to Windows, register the server or this listener in DNS service and get the IP address from the DHCP server. The final thing here is just how do I want to set this up, and I'll ask it to do automatically backup and restore the databases for me. We check that everything is okay to start, and then I can hit finish to go and set this up. The other interesting thing here is that I can also script this. So as you can notice down here, I can say, please script this to a file, meaning you get the full setup, exactly what we did, to a file, and you could put that into source control, for example, so you know exactly what setup you used. So while this is running, we can go ahead and look at my existing dashboard of the Fabricam availability group that I already have. So this is an interesting thing. I just right-clicked here and say show dashboard. And this will show me an overview of my availability groups. Now, obviously, the Contoso one is not set up yet. So I can go in here and see what is the state of this group. And as you can see, I can see for each machine that the SQL 5, it says data loss. That doesn't mean we're actually losing data. It means we're not guaranteeing no data loss. That means asynchronous commit. This is engineers versus marketing, right? So you see no data loss there as well. So let's go back to the wizard, and everything is done. And I'll go ahead and connect. And now let's use the name that I registered. So I'm connecting to Contoso 1 rather than any of the server names. And just select that server name. We can see that I got connected to SQL 4 because SQL 4 is the primary. And obviously, I can go ahead and issue queries and all of those things. Now, let me go ahead and instead connect to one of the secondaries. So I'll go ahead and change my connection and connect to SQL 5 instead. And you can see that I can now enter into the database, even though I'm on a secondary server, because it allows me to read from it. So again, I can see, just verify I'm on SQL 5, run the query. This again means I can now do reporting off of my secondary servers. So you're now getting load balancing, at least for your read-only workloads. And I can also go ahead and run a backup. Now I did backups. So I can offload more management tasks to my secondary servers than what I could do before, and I didn't need to do any additional setup or any additional configuration to get this working.
So I can run my maintenance wizards and my DBCCs as well?
Exactly. Everything except rebuilding your indexes, since that's a write operation.
Okay. Cool.
So the other thing I wanted to show you guys is what is my favorite, and I know Gert's favorite, and lots of other people's favorite feature of Always On. So I have a simple app here, and It just connects to one of the servers, right? Contoso Sales DB. And the only thing it does then is select at that server name and returns the name. So first of all, I'm going to say, please connect me to Contoso 1. I'll build this, run it, and you can see it connected to SQL 4 because that's the primary owner. Now, the amazing thing, maybe I should be in marketing. Amazing. It's very good. So, is that I can declare intent. So, if I want to connect and I only want to do read-only, I can say application intent equals read-only. So now I have to rebuild my demo app, but normally you would just pass a connection string in. So this also means that different parts of the same app could use application intent read-only versus not, depending on if you need to write or not. So if you build this into your app, and obviously you're reporting services solutions, you can offload lots of work from your primary machine. Before I can use this, I have to set up the routing for my read-only secondaries. So I'll just run this script. The only thing we do here is basically say, if SQL 5 is the, or on SQL 5, I accept read-only routing through this URL. And if SQL 4 is the primary, these are the read-only secondaries that it should try to connect to. Okay, so that's set up. We'll go ahead and rebuild. And now you can see I automatically got connected to SQL 5 instead, meaning I use my secondary workload, my secondary machine, and now without any configuration changes. Now everything happens on the server side if you want to offload your primaries. Thank you. Right.
Perfect. Thanks, Tobias. So this actually shows how we have been looking at requirements that you have, right, with regards to, hey, we need availability, but we don't want to have that hardware sitting there and just sitting there idle. Like, we want to be able to utilize this. And this actually demonstrates clearly is like how we can, how SQL Server 2012 instantly adds values to existing environments. So the other thing that we did in the requirements and data protection area is that we allow you to take backups and actually move them into Windows Azure. And what this actually gives you is the ability to store your applications into a vault that is in the cloud, which is backed by a geo-replicated store. So it gives you this extra dimension where you can go with your data or your backups. Now, the thing that we're working on, if you went to the keynote, you saw that we're actually working on VMs hosting SQL Server. And so one of the aspects that we're working on is like take the story from Tobias, and imagine that you now have a secondary that runs inside Windows Azure. And you can fail over to that secondary in Windows Azure. And that's how we're going to bridge the two worlds between the clouds and the on-premise world. So that's something that we're working at right now. So we've seen is like our work with regards to performance, security, and our availability. But it's like you need to be able to build a set of applications. And one of the key things that we're trying to do is make sure that you can leverage the same common architecture and application frameworks that you're using to be able to host that application on an on-premise server, on an appliance that is hosting SQL Server, if that's a database consolidation appliance, your private cloud, or a public cloud offering that has actually offerings or that offers the SQL Server database. Now, if we have those applications, scale is key. And one of the things that we've done, it's like we worked really, really hard with together with the Windows Server team, the Windows Server 2012 release, to actually up the capabilities for our SNMP scalability. So right now, it's like we're pushing the limit to up to 640 cores and 4 terabytes of memory, right? Which allows the biggest workloads to be actually run on our on SNMP hardware. Now, we also made a lot of investments in our database consolidation appliance, but not all applications are suitable or want to be able to scale up. We also have a new group of applications that actually wants to scale out, that wants to be able to use the TCO of the cloud and be able to use sharding patterns. And that's exactly what Windows Azure Database Federations are actually providing you. It provides you a mechanism to scale your database through configuration changes. Once you are in a federated mode, we automatically partition on the federation key, and we can add additional nodes based on your demands inside the server. Now, in order to get those applications up there, we actually need efficiency. We need to give you the usability and the capabilities to actually build those applications. So we don't have a lot of work in SQL Server Management Studio to actually integrate it and leverage it at the same levels of Visual Studio today. So you see a new SSMS, which is hosted in the latest Visual Studio shell, and we added a tool called SQL Server Data Tools, specifically targeted towards developers, which gives you a full T-SQL development environment with offline validation and compilation experiences and the ability to deploy your database projects multiple times to different targets in a seamless fashion, either on-premise or in the cloud. Now, those applications, we're actually, what we're seeing is that the reach of applications is getting broader and broader and broader. A couple of years ago, we started getting more calls about, we have a need to be able to host Linux clients or Unix clients up to SQL Server. So what we've done in SQL Server 2012, we added the ability to hook up PHP directly to SQL Server. We invested in our JDBC driver, so we're shipping a full Type 4 JDBC driver. And we added Linux support to our driver set. Now, those applications, the reach of these applications are not only determined by the platforms they run on, but also the data types that we're actually working with. So we added spatial support in the previous releases, and we've been actually plumbing this through to the whole stack also inside the BI world. Now, the other thing that we've done is we took full text and actually started extending this into a much broader world and added semantic search, the ability to actually work against the corpus of documents and be able to find all the semantic information within that corpus and expose that seamlessly in an integrated way, actually through a construct called file table. Now, one of our customers, TradeStation, who is actually a financial services company who gives you the ability to test your investment strategies. And they do that by actually mining over a corpus of documents that they've built up over 30 years. And the challenge they had was that managing all those documents became a very pain-taking experience. It took them multiple hours to actually build for the changes that came in that day. By moving to SQL Server 2012, they were able to actually build up a document management system leveraging the file table structure that centralizes their blobs and reduce their number of servers that they actually needed to gain efficiencies. Now, in order to show you how we can actually use that, I want to invite Michael back up and show us how we can what we can do with semantic search and file tables. So, Michael.
To build applications that not only can very easily deal with the deluge of unstructured data that you're getting more and more nowadays, but also how to gain valuable insight into that data without actually having to become necessarily a domain expert or pay for an expensive one at that. So I will show you now how you can use the two new SQL Server features that Kurt already mentioned, which is file table and semantic search, to basically build applications and use the database as an integrated store. So what you see here is I have a database that I've already created called Financials. It's using a file stream file group, which we already added in SQL Server 2008, that allows me to take large blob data and store it inside a streaming file system environment instead of inside the MDF file. In addition, now in SQL Server 2012, I have the ability to create a new type of table called the file table. Now, a file table is like any other T-SQL table. you can do a select on it. So in this case, for example, I say select star from file table, and of course I'm not in the right database. So let me quickly fix that. And so you're basically querying against the database here. And you see it's a normal table with a file stream column here that contains the blob data and that lives outside. Now, a file table, however, also has another property. It actually allows me to expose the data that is inside the table through an NTFS file share. So let me show you how that works. Over here, I have a new type of table, file tables, inside my management studio. I go and right-click on it. There's now a new option that is called Explore File Table Directory. So I'm going to select that. And what this does is it's actually opening an Explorer window that exposes the content of my file table as an NTFS file share. So if you look at this one here, you see I already have a directory called Annual Reports in here. And if I drill down into it, there's some more companies that I'm keeping track of. And if I go into those, you will notice that there are PDFs in there, etc. Now, actually, what I would like to do is I would like to add some additional financial news and run some analysis queries over those. So what I have is, let's say I have a news feed or some external device that has my financial news, and now I copy it into the database. Now, since file table is just an NTFS file share, I can just do a drag and drop and actually load these files into the table that I have seen earlier.
So this is a new way to do inserts?
That's a new way to do document inserts.
Okay.
You can't do that on every table. So let me show you now what I can do with that data to actually gain some interesting insights. So I can go and create a full text index on that column inside the file table. Now the index itself is now augmented with a new capability of not only doing the keyword indexing, but also identifying using some statistical language models what are the keywords that are most relevant to the document itself. And that's done without having to build semantic models or load ontologies. It's all based on just doing some analysis of what is inside the document. So I already created that full text index. So what I can do now is I can go and run some interesting queries. So the first query that I want to run over all my financial documents, both the analyst documents and the financial news documents, is a query about what are the articles that are about the NOOC. So what I do here is I run a query against the semantic key phrase table, and I just look at all the key phrases that start with NOOC in them. So I run them, and you see here there are lots of documents that are identified with NOOC in the context that have to do with Barnes & Noble. So that's kind of what I would expect. But remember, when I inserted that data, all the insertion that I did was what I just did earlier. So I didn't do like any Barnes & Noble specific or NOOC specific things. It all figured it out by itself. So now let's look at one of these documents, which is Microsoft buys a NOOC stake, and go and into some more detail about it. So now let's, for example, look at what are all the keywords that we identified in this document. So again, I go against the semantic key phrase table. I add the document ID this time. And we see the document identified Barnes Noble NOOC, which is basically what we are looking for, Microsoft. But it also bubbled up the concepts of the competing products like Android, like Amazon's Kindle, etc., and what is about ebooks, up into this corpus. Again, without me giving any domain-specific information. So now the next query is, let's look at some of the other documents that are related to this document. So not only can I figure out what the document is about, I can also find out what are all the other documents that are related to this one document. And I do that by querying and finding some interesting documents. And as we would expect, it finds lots of other Barnes & Noble and Microsoft-related documents about the NOOC. But it also finds, for example, that the Dow and S&P 500 slips as Spain enters the recession. Now, how do they relate? Why do they relate? Let's take a further look at this. So we have a fourth query that allows us to now see why these two documents are actually related. So what I do here is I use this very nicely named ROSAP provider here, Semantic Similarity Details Table, to actually look at why these two documents are related. So let's run this query. And indeed, they are related on things like Barnes, Noble, Nook, Microsoft, tablets, etc. But still, I'm not really sure why that has to do anything with the recession that started in Spain. So let me go back to the document. So I'm now back here again inside my file table. I drill into the financial news, and I search for Spain here. And there are two documents that are coming back. And the first one is the Dow and S&P 500 document that I mentioned earlier. So let's look at this. And now I just open the document out of the file table directly with my Word application. So a fully integrated store experience. I can now go and edit the document and save it back into the database. And I have all the benefits of backup, restore, etc., all behind the document given to me by the database. Now let's look at actually why these are related. And down here, we see that on the same day that this negative business news came about, Barnes & Noble actually announced with Microsoft that they would do that deal on the Nook. So that's why they are basically going to be related, because it happened to be on the same day. So I think that I've shown you now how easy it is to use the integrated store capabilities of SQL Server to build some really interesting applications using unstructured data. And now, thanks.
All right, thanks, Michael. Very powerful. So this actually is, again, another example of a very powerful addition that allows you to get more insight into the value that you already have, the data set that you already have inside your company, by exploring, by applying these new functionalities that we actually adding to SQL Server 2012 that allow you to gain dramatically more insightful knowledge about what's going on. So the next step actually is we need to be able to get those that data that we have, all the capabilities that we have, and expose them in new scenarios. So one of the things that we talked about, it's like we need to expand the reach of applications. Well, a lot of the new application form factors actually are on devices that don't have stateful connections. And this is where OData is actually a very important investment. This allows us to actually expose data in a RESTful way and allows us to unlock the information to a much broader set of devices. Our sync initiative, the data sync services, allows us to actually synchronize the data that you have on-premise between the data services that you have inside the cloud. And if you have a lot of data, it's like there is, and we're working on this marketplace thing, it's like the OData or the Windows Azure Marketplace, where people can bring their data so it can be consumed by others, but there are also very other, there are other interesting data feeds available, for example, for cleansing information or cleansing data. Right? Today, it's like I can walk up to the marketplace, get myself a data set that helps me clean my data. Now, in order, the data volumes are actually exploding. As we know, it's like there are about 500 people in this room. It's like probably you all carry a cell phone in some form, and so we're all collectively broadcasting a lot of GPS information, right? What we're doing with it, like, is it, we don't know, but it's like it's a lot of data. There's a lot of unstructured data that's digitally born that we need to be able to access and want to incorporate and unite with the structured data that we already have on-premise. Our bet on actually using unstructured data is by leveraging the Hadoop effort. So we're investing in Hadoop both as a service, as you will be able to see. It's like we're hosting Hadoop as a service inside Azure. Today that's in a private preview state. And we're working on actually getting Hadoop as a distributed compute fabric available on a Windows Server fabric as well, fully integrating into all the assets that you already have, like Active Directory and System Center and Visual Studio. Now, we keep investing in Parallel Data Warehouse. Right? We started this journey. It's like a year ago was like where PDW is actually allows you to run petabytes of a data warehouse on an appliance kind of machine that is fully managed and can run these workloads for you. Now, the key thing with all this data is that it needs to be consistent. You need to be able to rely on the quality of your data. So we've done a lot of work across the board to actually finish the semantic model work that we started in the analysis services work, but also added capabilities as master data services to give you a management handle on the process that you need to actually manage the data and make sure that it is consistent and reliable inside your system, in your environment. And we added this last capability in SQL Server 2012 called Data Quality Services, which allows you to clean your data sets. And while it's cleaning your data set, it actually is learning. And so it takes the learnings from the past and applies that into the future, which gives you a very rich environment to actually increase the quality of your data as it moves through your system. Now, the next part which we spend a lot of time on is to make sure that we can have a self-managing system. So we work together with the SharePoint team to make sure that the analysis services models, the Power View and the Power Pivot models that we have, that those can be managed in a self-servicing way through a SharePoint experience that allows us to import from Power Pivot into analysis services to create this self-serviced environment, which we actually will see in a moment. Now, with all this powerful data at our hands, it's like we need a way to actually get this in the hands of the user. We want to have a way to make sure that we can have reportings, but we can also alert the users when there are changes in those reports. So we added alerting to the reports. We added the self-service capabilities to reporting by the addition of Power View, which allows people to actually build a much richer reporting infrastructure over their existing data sets. Now, one of the customers, as like LG Chemical, which is a manufacturer, it's like they're using their reports to get insights about the thousands of products that they're actually dealing with. And they're doing this on a monthly basis. But their capacity didn't allow them to go beyond the standard reporting structure that they had. So today they have about 200 reports, but they didn't have the capacity to actually go beyond that and gain the insight in the data that they required. And so this led to all sorts of delays, like in terms of the research department determining is like the efficiency of that organization. So what they did is like they actually took Power View and made an environment of a self-service BI setup where they provided the end users to build those news reports, unlocking the IT infrastructure and be able to cut down their time spent on the reporting. Now, what I want to do next is like I want to ask Ricardo to come up and actually demonstrate to us it's like how we can leverage this ourselves inside our environment.
Thanks. So yeah, I wanted to.
Are you on?
Mic working? There we go. Okay. I wanted to give you just a glimpse of some of the investments that we've continued to make towards our managed self-service BI roadmap. Now, we really started this roadmap back in SQL Server 2008 R2 with Power Pivot. And Power Pivot went on to be a phenomenal success. It was named one of eWeek's top 10 products of the year. And what we did in this release is we built on the success of Power Pivot. We added some new BI features to it. The other thing that we did was we built out our roadmap of the spectrum of scenarios that we want to support. So now it's personal BI running on your desktop. It could be team BI, maybe running in SharePoint, but also now spanning all the way to enterprise BI in the sort of analysis services environment that you might be used to. Finally, the last thing that we did was we invested in rapid data exploration and rich interactive data visualization, and I'll show that a little bit later when we get to the Power View. So here I am in Power Pivot for Excel, and the beautiful thing about Power Pivot for Excel is that it feels just like Excel. So those users who would typically not be the type of users who would understand analysis services cubes or MDX or get involved with any of that. They now have access to a lot of the same features, and this has really expanded the reach of BI to a new audience. So I can pull in data from all the sorts of different data sources that you would expect, relational, multidimensional, and things that are beyond relational, right? I could pull data from OData services or from Windows Azure Data Market, or I could actually just copy and paste some data in my Excel worksheet and actually just sync that into this model as well. So, and that's a lot of what I've done here. And then all sorts of relational tabular modeling capabilities that are relatively simple to understand, we have them here. So we can create relationships from one column to another. If I go to this diagram view, which we've added in this release, you can see that it becomes evident that I'm not just building a spreadsheet here anymore. I'm actually building an analysis services BI semantic model. Whether the user knows that or not, that's what they're building. And the other thing is that they're actually building not just a workbook, but what's running in this workbook is an embedded instance of analysis services running in this sort of tabular mode. And it's using X velocity. So it's got this in-memory, column store, high compression engine that is incredibly fast. So you've got analysis services modeling and the analysis services engine right in Excel, and yet it's got all the usability of Excel. So somebody who's used to creating pivot tables and pivot charts, it's no more complicated than that. So when it goes beyond personal BI, I just wanted to show you one quick thing, which was an example of a new feature that we created. If I go here, for example, and I've got a measure in Power Pivot, we're adding the sort of traditional BI capabilities that you would be used to in an analysis services cube right in Excel. So here, for example, we've got a KPI and a really easy way for users to define a KPI. We've also added hierarchies. We have also added perspectives. A lot of those capabilities you're used to in a cube right now in the Excel model. So going beyond personal BI, this is just running on my desktop, but what happens when I want to share this with my team or maybe share this with my department? Well, the answer to that is I can push it up to SharePoint, which is the way I share all these sorts of documents with my team. And as soon as I do that, two things happen, right? It becomes something that's visible to my team. So here we can see I've got a nice Power Pivot gallery in SharePoint and a really nice way of browsing through all the workbooks. I can open it up in Excel services. I can interact with it in the browser. So my team has access to it now. But at the same time, what Power Pivot for SharePoint is it's actually an analysis services instance running in a sort of SharePoint integrated mode. So all the queries that are hitting these workbooks, they're all traced just like any queries to an analysis services instance. So, and what we actually do is we actually ship a Power Pivot management dashboard out of the box. So out of the box, you get this nice dashboard, and this is where the IT oversight comes in, right? I can see all these queries that are being executed against these workbooks over time. Are they very quick, which looks like to be the case in this case, or are some of them taking a long time and eating a lot of computing resources? I can see my list of most popular workbooks, so I can keep track of these workbooks that are growing in popularity. And here I've even got an animated bubble chart where I can show on one axis the number of queries, on another axis the number of users that are using these workbooks, and keep an eye on which workbooks I might want to think about what level of resources I'm allocating to them, or maybe at some point they've become too big to be sort of team or departmental BI solutions and I need to promote them to be actual enterprise solutions. So, and this is part of the whole idea of Microsoft Self-Service BI, which is that somebody creates a little Excel spreadsheet on their desktop and they use it for a few days and then that's pretty well it. I don't want to be bothered by those and I want to let them go and do that. Things that I'm concerned about are those things that are seeing a large number of queries being executed against them, or those things that have gained popularity and now there are 100 users or 1,000 users in a team or department that are using them. Those are the ones that I want to keep an eye on them. So I mentioned that we have personal BI, we have team BI. One of the things that we wanted to do in this release was complete the spectrum, going all the way up to corporate BI and enterprise BI. So the way we did that was, let's say one of these workbooks gets really large, thousands of users are using it, it's got a lot of query volume, we want to do things like row-level security on it, we want to do things like partitioning on it, advanced things that go beyond a workbook in SharePoint. What I can do is I can actually go over to SQL Server Management CEO, and I've got my analysis services tabular instance. It hosts the same sort of tabular models that you've seen in the workbook, but in a regular analysis services instance outside of SharePoint. And what I can do here is I can restore a database, so I can restore an ABF file just like you're used to, but I can also restore from Power Pivot. And here I just point it to the workbook, and I pull it in, and it becomes an analysis services database, and then I can do all that row-level security and all that advanced stuff. Really cool. Now, I might go straight to that step if I just wanted to pull in the database in and give it a little bit more scale, or maybe add some row-level security, but if I want to do additional modeling, that's where Visual Studio comes in. And in Visual Studio here, I can open up, I've got a model here. And what you'll see is that it's got the same sort of modeling experience that you've got in Excel. The same sort of thing in Visual Studio. I'll just give this a second. There we go. So you see the same sort of modeling experience in Visual Studio, and yet we've got all these advanced capabilities. We've got source control, all the sorts of stuff you would expect. And then, again, similar capability, I can actually, if I wanted to not start from scratch, I can create a new project. Oops, sorry. Create a new project. And I can create an analysis services tabular project from scratch and get this sort of experience. But I can also, again, do that import from PowerPivot and then continue to work with the model. So some scenarios where that is really useful, it could be something that an information worker or a data analyst has created that I want to take control of. But we've also heard from customers that PowerPivot, even for BI professionals, is a really great lightweight prototyping tool. So you can start doing your prototyping in PowerPivot, and then when you realize it's something that you want to do long term, you pull it into Visual Studio and make it a robust enterprise solution. The last piece of the puzzle that I mentioned was PowerView. What we did with PowerView was we wanted to really shift our focus away from the modeling for a second and think about data exploration and data visualization. So what we've built is this really interactive data exploration, visualization, and even presentation experience. It's running right in SharePoint, and it's running in the browser. So what I can do here is I can just click on, for example, media. I'm just going to click on this entity in the semantic model. And just like that, automatically we get a default set of fields. If I open this up, you'll see that it checked some fields and not others by default. And it may seem like magic, but what's really going on here is there's so much rich metadata in the semantic model. So the person who designed the model said that this subset of the fields is the most interesting subset of fields. And when we add this entity by default, this is what we should add. And there are all sorts of little tweaks that you can do like that in the model that will drive and influence the behavior in PowerView. And there's actually a session on building the perfect BI semantic model for PowerView that I would highly encourage you to go to learn more about that. Another really cool thing about PowerView is I can easily convert from one visualization to another. So when I'm looking at a list of things, I can convert it to this card type of visualization, which is really nice. Now I'm going to just build out a quick analysis here. I'll grab the rating, and I'll grab the gross revenue, and convert that to a column chart really quick. And then I will also grab maybe the rating, or sorry, the genre and the gross, make that a bar chart. And again, because of the semantic model, we know how everything is interrelated. I can just click on this, for example, and get some automatic cross-highlighting, cross-filtering. Whereas in a lot of competitive tools, you typically have to do a lot of hooking up of these things and say, when I click on this column chart, go and filter this and highlight that, and this is just automatic. Now, I mentioned finally that this is all about data visualization and presentation. So when I build out this story, I can build multiple views in my report here. I can build out a nice logical flow, and I can go and present this full screen. We've got some nice full screen views. But maybe this is just going to be a part of a larger presentation, like this presentation that we're doing here today, and I just want to incorporate BI as a part of that. So I may already have a presentation, or I may want to build out a presentation. My general purpose presentation tool for doing that is PowerPoint. So what I want to do is I want to get this into PowerPoint. And it's really easy to do that because we built export to PowerPoint right into the product. So I can just click here. I've already done that earlier, and I've built and I've exported this presentation. And you can see that the view of what we saw when we exported is what shows up there. Just give this a sec. But beyond that, I can actually click to interact. And what's actually going to happen is it's going to load PowerView directly in PowerPoint. It's going to go to SharePoint, and it's going to load the report. You'll see it come up here in a sec. And we're actually running PowerView in PowerPoint, running the queries, seeing fresh data. My demo machines all seem to have jet lag today. There we go. And I can interact with the report in the exact same way that I could have in the browser. So, for example, I can pop this out and actually play this bubble chart. And you might have seen something like this before, but probably not in PowerPoint. So these are the sorts of things that are now possible to do in PowerPoint. So there you go. There's a quick whirlwind tour of what we've done in Managed Self Service BI. And I'll hand it back to you. Thanks.
Thanks, Ricardo. So what you've seen today is like, as Ricardo ended, is like a whirlwind tour across SQL Server 2012. And hopefully you agree with me that it's like
there is a lot of things in there, and hopefully there's a lot of value for yourself to actually start using it right now. So with that said, it's like there are about 40 sessions covering BI and databases at this conference. I highly encourage you to actually go check them out. We have a bunch of labs. It's like we have instructor-led workshops. I'm presenting the Cloud Ready Data Services this afternoon in the theater. So with that said, thank you very much for attending, and have a great TechEd. Thank you.